So let's get started. A quick overview of the agenda. We'll introduce a topic. We'll then explain the persistence needs and requirements that we define for API platform as a service. Then we'll explain how we came to select DataStax Enterprise Search as our main persistence technology. Then we'll move to the main technical challenges that we faced and how we solved them. And then we conclude and save some time for questions and answer. So a few words about us. So I'm Jerome Louvel. I'm the founder and CTO of Restlet. So we are a web API platform vendor. I created the Restlet framework about 10 years ago. It was the first open source REST framework for Java developers. It's still one of the main framework in Java, was contributor to several books, including RESTful Web Services, a co-author of Restlet in Action, published by Manning in 2012. Part of the JAXRS expert group who defines the standard Java APIs to create and consume web APIs. And I'm currently an editor for InfoQ on the web APIs topics.
I'm Guillaume Blondeau, so I'm DevOps engineer at Restlet, and I'm currently working on API Spark platform. So I have less bullet points than Jerome, but I added one yesterday by becoming a Cassandra administrator certified administrator. So,
okay. Thanks, Guillaume. So quick overview of the Restlet API platform, and then we'll dive in the cloud part of the platform. So it's composed of three components, the open source framework that I mentioned. In addition, we have the Restlet Studio, which is a web IDE to craft visually APIs and generate client SDK and server skeletons. And finally, we have a cloud platform called API Spark, it's a platform as a service. And this platform, in the end, covers the full life cycle of an API project, including the design, the deployment, and the management of your APIs. So API Spark, in more details, key features, visual creation, and deployments of data-driven APIs, so the APIs as well as the underlying data stores. We not only create and deploy them, but actually host them, operate the APIs and the underlying data stores, with the option to connect to external data sources as well. And we can manage any type of APIs, created or not on the API Spark. So, and the traffic can go through our platform or can go directly to your final APIs, and we provide a remote proxy to manage it for you visually. Benefits is that the most of the platform is accessible visually from a web browser. You don't need a deep technical expertise about APIs to create and deploy one. And a company of any size can become API providers, and developers can get started for free. And then their company can pay as the traffic on the API is increasing or as you store a significant amount of data beyond the free quota. So what about the persistence needs of an API pass? What were the main goals that we wanted to solve and to provide to our customer? First, the high availability of APIs, which includes as well the availability of the underlying data stores. If you need an API that is always up when you power mobile applications for your customers and users, when you power application from your partners through APIs, but you also need to make sure the underlying data store is as well very highly available. Otherwise, it will impact your API, obviously. Second requirement, low latency for users that can be spread across the world. For example, if you are running a mobile application to provide data on the Ruby World Cup. You want to have a replica of your data and the API as close as possible, for example, from European users and from South Africa visitors and Australia visitors and so on. And if your data is not read-only, you need to have an active replication of your data across multiple regions. So it's becoming a very common requirement. Next one, high scalability and elasticity. So we want our platform to cope with increasing API traffic on specific APIs, customers' APIs. It terms of concurrency, in terms of various types of workloads, read mostly, write only APIs, or mix of both, and an ability as well to handle peak loads very easily. So same for data storage, ability to host, store many data stores, many databases for customers and their projects, and as well to grow when they store, you know, an increasing amount of data as well. So elasticity and scalability in many dimensions. Next, we wanted to provide a very rich query capabilities, which is not always the strongest part of a NoSQL database, for example. So ability to filter on one or many properties, ability to paginate, to sort, and potentially to do full text indexing and so on. Next a requirement, final one, the high multi-tenant density. So we want, for as a public platform as a service, to host data and APIs for many customers on the same shared infrastructure. So we want to provide the best balance between data isolation from each customer and the low cost. We can't afford to create a new ring for each customer, so we have to share at least part of this persistence infrastructure. And we need to be able to deal with various level of access to the data, data specific to an individual user, data that can be shared among a group of users or public data, and so on. So now let's talk about the selection process that, you know, led us to select DataStax Enterprise Search. So first, when we prototype API Spark a few years ago, we started, we had a small team and wanted to use a NoSQL database that was operated by Amazon Web Services. So we started with SimpleDB. It's nice, it's highly available, low latency. It's only available in one region at the same time. And it has limited query capabilities. So it was okay to get started, and then we upgraded to DynamoDB, which was released a few months after we started. Better scalability, predictability, but we found out it was not really suitable for multi-tenant type of use cases. So many soft limits are built in the technology, so we felt that it was really not it was not going to scale for our needs down the road. Not very elastic. You have to know in advance your load and to provision and to set the actual throughput that you will have, and you will be build on this provision throughput. So not very elastic and kind of costly in the end. Other limitation we found out the difficulty to develop and test locally. So you always need a connection to the cloud, and again it was getting expensive to do a load test and so on. So we had to develop a MySQL a local mode in our persistence layer. So additional complexity, and in the end, a strong lock-in with Amazon Web Services. So we decided, as we moved to the better version of API Spark, we decided to move to Apache Cassandra. So it was much better for multi-tenancy needs in terms of cost, obviously, as it's free. And in addition, we knew we could get some commercial support from DataStax when we were moving to production. Ability to deploy on-premise for, you know, key partners, for large customers, in addition to the public platform of service, was really becoming more important. And we knew it would scale on top of Amazon Web Services, which is still today our cloud infrastructure provider. We got this nice benchmark and feedback from Netflix and so on. So we felt comfortable doing this move. We got access to richer query capabilities through SQL, even though it's not exactly what we are looking in the end, but it was a good step forward. And we had access to these multi-region capabilities and native to Cassandra, so that was great. And the final step was to upgrade to a DSC and the search edition of DSC when we moved and when we prepared to move to the GA version of API Spark at the end of last year. So certified stack, ready for production with actual support in production, hot fixes, and so on when we had issues. And we got, you know, improved capabilities in terms of query, thanks to the integration of Solr native to DSC, and access to a Visual Console and better command line tools for the operation, comprehensive documentation. As the team was growing in the engineering, it was really important to have this kind of quality of software and service around it. still an open source foundation, so it's a limited vendor locking, which is important for us and the foundation on mature open source components. So quick overview of our persistence design today. So in the API Spark cloud platform, our customers can create their own entity store, their own tables, their own database. An entity store can contain multiple entities. An entity is equivalent to a table in SQL, as you can see on the top right. And each of these entity stores has an equivalent Cassandra table and an equivalent Solar document. So everything is consistent in terms of schema, description. An entity contains multiple properties with one that is a primary key. And those properties map to columns in the table, SQL table, and map to field in the Solar document. So that's the way we mapped and we implement our persistence. So now Guillaume will talk you through the seven main challenges that we faced by when we implemented DSE and how we solved those challenges. Guillaume.
Okay, thanks, Jerome. So one more detail is that we're currently using DataStax Enterprise Search 4.6 with Cassandra 2.0, which has impacts for our design. So first challenge was to, as Jerome said, was to deploy across multiple regions. So to handle that, we use the EC2 multi-region snitch. So we hosted on AWS, and it let us create a cluster across multiple AWS regions. So one Cassandra key space matched to one AWS region, and one Cassandra rack matches to one AWS availability zone. So we are with our current design, one entity store is one key space. So we are able to customize the replication policy and the regions where the customer's data is hosted. So for my first entity store and key space, the replication policy is free in US West 2, which is Oregon region, but we might be able to set it differently for another entity store and another customer, so we are able to customize it. Then the second challenge is to be able to isolate customer data while keeping the cost low. So this is done natively in Cassandra because physically in the file system, key space data are separated. So we can see that key space data is in different folders. And it's also isolated in memory because Cassandra mem tables are segregated. One complementary benefit is that we can create some access control list per key space. So for each different user, we can use a SQL statement grant permission, and each user can only access to its own key space. So it can only access to its own data, which is very important in a multi-tenant path. So then we want to be able to support complex data models. So in my contact entity, I want to be able to create an address property, which is a nested properties as it contains a street, a city, and a country. So to handle that, we have created in SQL an address property, which is a text, and it is represented as JSON in this text. So we could use Cassandra user-defined type, but we still using Cassandra 2.0, which does not yet support it. So that's why we created a JSON in the text property. And then I want to be able to create list properties. So here my contact has a list of hobbies. So he likes playing squash, soccer, and badminton. And to build it, we used the Cassandra built-in list. So we can have several elements in the list. One drawback useful to know is that each element of the list cannot exceed the size of 64 kilobytes. And if we have a big composite in a big composite to store, it can exceed this side, and that's not great. So next, we want to be able to deal with dynamic schema changes. So a customer might want to change his schema. So for example, in his contact entity, he deleted the property date of birth and added address and obese properties. So how do we represent that in Cassandra? So we have a lot of authorized actions. So we can create and delete an entity. So for example, I want to create my contact entity. So it's done in Cassandra thanks to the SQL statement create table. And we also have to create the Solar Core, so via the Solar HTTP API. So we post a new schema for the Solar Core. So we are also able to delete the entity via the drop table SQL statement. We also are able to create and delete a property. So with the SQL statement alter table add, and then we have to update the Solar schema via also via the HTTP API, Solar API. And then one tricky thing is we want to be able to add or delete properties inside composites. So for example, I want to add a city to my address property. So as we're using JSON in text properties, we can't use Cassandra built-in function. So we have to browse all rows and then alter the JSON schema. So in our application, and this is for now a pain point, and we are looking forward to be able to use user-defined types. Then, when dealing with dynamic schema changes, we have the following advantages. So the main advantage is the flexibility compared to relational databases, because there are no lock. It means that we are still able to use our data. The API has no downtime and is still usable while we change the schema. So even if we make some alteration in the schema, the table and the data is still available and we can still use it. And there is no maintenance windows. So Cassandra provides also a lot of available actions. So we can add and drop a column, but we can also rename it. And just in under certain conditions, we can change the type of the column. So Cassandra comes also with some limitations. So the schema deployment, what I call schema deployment, is schema modification and the propagation to all nodes of the cluster can take some time. So when we want the data to be live as soon as possible. And in some edge case, we can't recreate column. So for example, my hobbies property, which is a list of text, if I drop it and recreate it as the list of integer, Cassandra won't be able to do that, and it will say, you had a list of text in the past, so I can create a list of integer. So there are some limitations, and I hope they will be fixed. So next, as Jerome explained, we want to have a high multi-tenant density. So with several, with multiple customers in the same cluster. So here is a graph indicated the time taken by several schema changes with a growing number of tables. So we have four actions, which are table deletion and creation, column deletion and creation, which are stable with this numbered growing number of tables. They last about 1 second, which is quite good for our customer. But we can see the last action, which is the Solar Index creation, that its deployment time increases with the growing number of tables. So the more tables and Solar Core we have on our cluster, the more time schema index makes to deploy. So in an empty cluster, it's about 2 seconds in our test. And it's a crowded cluster, it's about 7 seconds. So it can be a pain point for our customers as they have to wait for their data to be live. So our challenge is to be able to deal with a large number of Cassandra tables on Solar Core. And with Cassandra, a table consumes at least 1 megabyte of heap. So the more tables we have, the more memory it consumes. And we have to deal with that fact. So what were the solutions we found? We had to adjust the JVM memory settings. So we increased the amount of heap of the Cassandra JVM. But we have to be careful not to increase it too much, because we will have stop the world garbage collection, and our Cassandra instance will be frozen for a certain amount of time. So the next solution was to create additional clusters. So when a cluster was crowded, we just had to create a new one, and then new customers will deploy their data on this new cluster, and we'll have better performances. And then we can also deprovision unused entity stores, because some customers just try the application, create their data sets, and then don't come back. So we deprovision their data and are able to host new customers' data. So as Jerome explained, we want to have some query capabilities. So on the right of this sketch, we can see our DSC stack, so with Cassandra and Solar, which are synchronized. And we can have two types of queries in API Spark, so write queries. For example, when we do a post or a delete request on our API, the request goes to the entity store, and then the entity store transmits the request to Cassandra via the data stack driver. And then when the customers want to make a search on his data, for example, on his contacts, he makes a get on the API, and the data is transmitted to Solar via the Solar J driver. So we prefer using Cassandra data stack driver for writes, because the DataStax driver is cluster aware, so it will have better performance and better failovers than the SolarJ driver, which has just a simple load balancing policy. And we could have used the Solar queries via SQL statements, but in DSC 4.6, it's not yet production ready. So in the next version, we'll do all our queries via the DataStax driver and SQL statement to have better performances. So here are some examples of queries via Solar. So filtering on a property, pagination, and sortings. So these are basic queries made on Solar. So last but not least, we want to be able to provide analytics on each API. We want to provide analytics, for example, the latest API calls of an API with some additional data. And we also generate some reports. So the number of calls per API over the months, or the report about the duration of the API calls. So how did we design this with Cassandra? We created, for the report, we created one table per report. So for the number of calls per month, so we created a table, web API call log period, so on the left. And we designed the primary key to be as efficient as possible. So the partition key is cell, which is the API identifier. Then we have the version of the API, version 1, version 2. And then the period, so the month, for example, September. the month of September. And then we use Cassandra counters. So this is quite efficient because for each API call, we just made a plus one on the counter So it's quite easy. And we didn't have a performance issue. It works quite well, very well. So then for the latest API calls and other analytics, we use a table called a web API call log, which gathers all the data useful for an API call. So the primary key is designed as the following. The partition key is still the API identifier. We still have the version as clustering colon. And we also added the date of the call, which is a time UID. And for ordering purpose, we added an order in descending order on the date, so that if we want to retrieve the last 10 API calls, we just have to do a select star from web API call log where cell equals API identifier limit 10. So we just already have the 10 last call, and it's very efficient and very easy to retrieve. But with this design, we found an issue, which is an issue with write rows. So for heavily used APIs, for example, for APIs with thousands or tens of thousands calls, we had write rows, so many rows per partition key. So it is a bottleneck. And to solve that, we just can make a composite partition key and add, for example, in this partition key, the week number or the month number. So we just have to, so we know we won't have too many calls and too many API calls per partition key. So now the conclusion of this talk.
Thank you very much, Guillaume. As a conclusion, we are in kind of a special use case for Cassandra. Many of our requirements match directly Cassandra and DataStax Enterprise capabilities in terms of high availability, scalability, and so on. But what we found was special in our case was really the high density, multi-tenancy, and the fact that we are pushing some limits in terms of number of tables we can store in a cluster and so on. So we couldn't find a lot of public shared knowledge about it, but we had some great support from DataStax, from their technical online support, from their consultants as well. So that helped us move forward and solve our issues. So we feel really like DataStax Enterprise is a good fit for our use case, despite some just natural challenges for new technologies. So we're pretty happy about it and excited about the new version 4.8 that was announced today. Especially the user data, the user defined types, and their automatic indexing in Solr. It's something that is going to be really useful for composite properties and our ability to search them deeply. In addition, the live indexing of Cassandra data into Solr will reduce the latency between when data is written by through an API and when it's available for query. Sometimes you have a small delay, and so this new design will be useful for our users. And generally speaking, improve overall performance is going to be nice. So that's it. Thank you very much. So I would say we do have some limits in terms of tenants. But it's more through the number of tables or the number of Solr cores. So one tenants could be very active and create 10, 20 tables, and another one will be less active and will be happy with just one table and Solr document. So I would say it more depends on the actual activity. But so we do monitor for each cluster the maximum number of tables and the impact on especially on the deployment. A time for the schema, as Guillaume explained, and we control the performance to know when we reach this limit to move to a new cluster.
So do you have across, do you ever migrate tenants across clusters? Like, let's say you've got 10 tenants on there and you're reaching the upper limit of tables and right, because the tenant may add more tables to hit your upper limit of like 500 tables. Do you ever do cluster migration?
So we don't do that. It's more based on the entity store. So when you create a new entity store and you deploy it, at this point, I guess we make the decision on, you know, what is the available cluster to handle this entity store. Do you want to add something, Guillaume? No? Okay. Yeah. Any other question? Yes.
How do you achieve tenant isolation? Do you basically put different tenants in different key spaces and just let them play in that space, or do you ever have tenants within key spaces? And yeah.
So to achieve tenant isolation, we have one key space per entity store. So one customers owns its entity store. So isolation is made. Multiple customers have multiple key space, so each customer has each key space. So that's why it's isolated, and as I've shown, it's isolated in the file system and also in memory.
Okay, so you do schema isolation then. Okay, yeah. So you do schema isolation. So each tenant gets its own key space, and you never kind of mix it where you'd have tenants in the same schema and then try to isolate it by tenant ID in the tables, right? You don't do that.
No. That's correct. We have isolation at the schema level, and on top of DSE, we have our own application layer at the API level, and even under the API, we have our own representation of an entity store. So we do some extra security validation at this level as well before even trying to access DSE. So we have tenancy at all the levels, I would say, of our architecture.
I see. And have you seen attack vectors where a kind of a rogue tenant tries to kind of grab other tenants' data? So what sort of authentication or protection do you have in place at your application layer?
So it's really based on the API. The API has its own authentication mechanism. So when you want to access an API, you have to authenticate. You have to provide your key, and based on that, you get some credentials. And based on that, you have access or not on, you know, the relevant key space and the associated data. So it's it's handled this way.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Yes.
Excuse me. Sorry about that.
Oh, one second. Yeah, with the microphone, it's going to be better.
So about this using separate key space for each and every tenant, right? I think after some time, the performance degrades if there are more number of key space. So I don't know what kind of experience you guys had on that. So suppose you have 1,000 customers at some point, you'll probably end up having 1,000 key spaces, right? Because you're separating the customers based on key space. So do you had any kind of an what was your performance aspect of it based on the way you're designing your schema, since you're separating it out based on key space?
So yeah, as far as I know, and Guillaume, yeah, maybe you want to add something, but we don't see having, you know, a lot of key space being a significant issue, like a bottleneck. Today the bottleneck is more the solar. The number of solar core per cluster. This one has been the bottleneck that we hit, the soonest, I would say. So
I read some feedback that there is no really impact of the number of key space, but we did not measure it, so I can't confirm you, but it seems there is no issue on the number of key space.
Any other question? Yes.
I
How do you track per tenant usage? Is that some opaque field that you add when they create or alter data and you generate a report from that? Or is there some other mechanism you scrape the logs or send an event? Or how do you track that?
Sorry, can you repeat your question?
Per tenant usage for billing purposes, for example, or when they're creating a new table, is there some opaque field that's added to the table that tracks which particular tenant did what at what time, or how are you tracking all of their usage of the database?
So it's hard to understand. There is some. Was the question about what happens when we do a lot of modification on table on its schema and it's something.
No. How are you tracking per tenant usage?
Oh, we are monitoring.
Yeah.
So we are storing a log of access in terms of at the API level. So that's one way we monitor. And in addition, maybe Guillaume, you want to give some details on how we monitor the data consumptions on the cluster, or you don't have the details. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. We can get back to you later and give you my card. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
All right. Take care, guys.